Has this ever happened to you? It's the year 2000 and you're on the development staff of a game called Animal Crossing. Your boss says, we want to be able to play NES games inside Animal Crossing. That would be really cool. You've been hired to make NES games run on the Nintendo 64. You need to learn how the CPU works, how the picture processing unit works, and also how the audio processing unit works. For both consoles. And then, 25 years after you figured it all out, someone on the internet made an accuracy test ROM and then ran it in your NES emulator and gave you a list of 115 things you did wrong. Has that ever happened to you? Well, as it turns out, that did happen, and it all began when an interesting thought entered my mind. The Wii Virtual Console is banned from several speedrun categories on speedrun.com. Why is that? And instead of awkwardly asking the moderation staff why that is, I did what a normal person would do and wrote 15,000 lines of fully commented assembly. The code I wrote will test 125 things you might be doing wrong with your NES emulator. Did I say 125? I meant 780, because these tests all have multiple error codes to narrow down specifically what your emulator does wrong. Without further delay, allow me to introduce my accuracy test ROM, Accuracy Coin. Link to the GitHub in the description. This is an in-ROM cartridge, specifically testing for behavior present in the most common revision of the CPU and PPU chips. Attention! If you or a loved one are developing a NES emulator, you may want to consider running my test ROM on it. Decades of old and in some cases entirely incorrect accuracy test ROMs may have put the accuracy of your emulator at risk. In this video, I'll showcase what Nintendo's emulators get wrong, and if applicable, how that affects speedruns performed on them. Let's go! To my knowledge, the earliest released official NES emulator is inside Excitebike 64. By completing the tutorial, you unlock the ability to play the NES game inside the N64 game. Whoa! And through the power of computer science, I was able to run my accuracy test ROM on this emulator. Now, unfortunately, I think this emulator is hard-coded to use the pattern data for Excitebike despite my best efforts, so it looks like this. Which is not ideal. Before we start talking about the results, let's understand what we're looking at here. This ROM has 20 pages of tests, and each test is just checking for some specific behavior of the Nintendo Entertainment System. For example, let's look at ROM is not writable, as that's a pretty easy test to understand. Suppose you wanted to verify that read-only memory is not writable. The best way to go about doing this is to have a specific address on the ROM with a known value, attempt to write there, and then read from that address after the attempted write. If the value is different after writing there, then the test has failed. And to run my test in my ROM, you can simply move the cursor over that test and press the A button. Before we see the results of every test, let's take a look at what we're testing for. We've got some amusing CPU behavior, some edge cases surrounding address wraparound, 9 pages dedicated to the unofficial opcodes, interesting interrupt behavior, interesting DMA behavior, audio chip behavior, power on state, some picture processing unit edge cases, precise frame timing, sprite evaluation, this really obscure PPU behavior, and some more CPU stuff that relies on a lot of properly emulated edge cases, which are difficult to verify. And now, let's see how Excitebike 64 does on these tests. Here are the results of every test in a table. The columns are the 20 pages of my ROM, and the rows are just the index into a page. This table can actually be generated by my ROM, but I had to do some Photoshop here. Not because I never figured out how to make this emulator use my ROM's graphics, rather it crashed in a lot of these tests. All the X's here are tests that crashed the emulator. Most of these crashes occur when running an unofficial instruction, but this emulator also crashed running the decimal flag test. I honestly don't know what could have gone wrong there. So anyway, this emulator passed 5 out of 125 tests. You might be thinking, wow, that's awful, but that's actually par for the course for an emulator made in the year 2000. Oh, and by the way, this emulator cannot run Super Mario Brothers. Due to pushing the wrong value for the return address of JSR instructions, the concept of a jump table simply doesn't work on this emulator. So, let's give a final evaluation for this emulator. First of all, considering this emulator is unable to play Super Mario Brothers, I'm immediately giving this emulator a failing grade. Keep in mind, most of these tests are for edge case behavior, things that don't normally affect the gameplay of any first-party titles. Passing 5 tests out of 125 is an alarming score, but very few of these tests would actively prevent a first-party title from running. So in summary, it can run Excitebike just fine, but that is the extent of this emulator. But this was only the humble beginnings. Let's move on and talk about the emulator made for Animal Crossing. Though there's no official name for this emulator, the Animal Crossing disassembly refers to it as KSNES. This emulator was actually reused quite a bit. It was used in Metroid Prime, The Legend of Zelda Collector's Edition, Super Smash Bros. Brawl, but the most notable reuse of this emulator is the Wii Virtual Console, shown here having the exact same results as KSNES. But also, the screen is darker, for some reason. In my opinion, the most important tests in this ROM for determining if an emulator is good enough for speedrunning are the frame timing tests. Imagine you're at a bus stop. At the end of every single frame, a bus arrives, except when the bus is under maintenance, which for this analogy will be the screen transition. If the maintenance takes too long, you need to wait an entire additional frame before the bus can arrive. You might not think of it this way, but when you enter World 1 Level 6, you are experiencing 11.95 frames of lag. But of course, if the maintenance ends in that 0.05 frame window, the bus can still arrive on the 12th frame. While most of this maintenance period is deterministic, some factors take up a variable amount of CPU cycles. The game wants to prepare the values on the HUD scoreboard, as well as prepare the color palettes of Mario based on his power-up state, in what is easily the most poorly written subroutine in the entire game. By manipulating your score and power-up, you could cause just enough additional lag to cause the bus to miss. However, on an emulator with improper frame timing, this 0.05 frame window could be larger, resulting in no lag frame when one should be present. So you can see why failing these tests is a pretty big red flag. FCEUX, shown here failing these tests, was used to create the warpless TAS of Super Mario Bros. However, inside World 3-1 on frame 17,407 of the TAS, due to improper frame timing, an edge case known as NMI suppression should have occurred, but did not. The result of which is, on actual hardware, a lag frame, but under these exact same conditions on the FCEUX emulator, the lag frame is not present, hence the ban from the speedrun leaderboards. In addition to the frame timing, well, there's a lot wrong with this emulator, but most notable for speedruns is the lack of unofficial instructions. Speedruns featuring arbitrary code exploits, such as the any% run of Super Mario Bros. 3, involve executing code from RAM. Since RAM is, in most cases, not easy to manipulate, there's a high probability of executing an unofficial instruction. By lacking the unofficial instructions, you could very easily run code that should crash the game, but instead does not. Alright, it's time to evaluate this emulator. Once again, we're looking at some alarming results. 10 out of 125 is still not great. That being said, it didn't crash running any of my tests, so I'm gonna give it some bonus points. I'm giving this emulator a C-. It's far from perfect, it has some weird quirks, but it runs pretty well. In 2004, Nintendo released the classic NES series for Game Boy Advance, which was a NES emulator for the Game Boy Advance. The first thing you'll notice is that the graphics are just... well... Mario has seen better days. Running my test ROM on this emulator is a bit of a mess. For the recording here, I modified the ROM so the tests that would have crashed the emulator simply return error code 0, which allows me to generate that table. And just look at it, all squished like that. That's great. It passed 4 tests. Alright, the final evaluation. It does run Super Mario Bros., so it's not failing, but wow, these results are rough. It crashes in 2 of my tests, and the ones that it passes are not particularly impressive. This is passing, but barely. D. But in 2011, the Nintendo 3DS hit store shelves, and with it came the Nintendo 3DS Virtual Console. Scoring 17 out of 125, this appears to be Nintendo's best emulator yet. It does crash on a few tests though, so let's talk about that. The unofficial instructions are an interesting case. Though they still act as no-op instructions, leaving our registers or RAM unaffected, they do have the correct number of operands, which is a step up from all the previous emulators. And what I found to be most surprising is that the unofficial LAX and SAX instructions are fully implemented. Well, except for LAX absolute with offset X, which is incorrectly emulated as it doesn't affect the A register. And though the ISC instructions are behaving like no-ops as well, for some mystery reason, ISC absolute with offset Y doesn't have the correct number of operands. And both zero-page forms of ISC crash the entire 3DS. But what's really interesting is that this emulator appears to have 2 different modes. There's the NES mode, you know, that runs NES games, and then there's the Game Boy mode, that can also run NES games. And I cannot stress this enough, but the NES-exclusive mode is the only one that crashes running these opcodes. I don't know. The final evaluation for this emulator. I'm giving some partial credit for the half-implemented unofficial instructions. This emulator is pretty much in the same area as the Animal Crossing emulator. It runs a lot of NES games quite well, despite the issues it has with many, many edge cases. It actually fails a few that the Animal Crossing emulator got right, but I am going to score it higher simply because it at least tries with the unofficial instructions. Slightly. I'm giving this one a C. And then, in 2013, the Wii U Virtual Console arrived, and they made a brand new NES emulator. With a decade worth of potential improvements, how well does the Wii U Virtual Console do on these tests? 9 out of 125. That's worse than the Wii Virtual Console! I'll be honest, with this emulator I don't have much to say. This one scores a C-, right there with the Wii VC. And then, 3 years later, we saw the release of the NES Classic Edition. A mini NES bundled with 30 NES games. I don't mean to shatter the illusion, but this is actually just a Linux computer running an emulator. Alright, how'd they do this time? Oh. I just want to remind you what these results have looked like for the entirety of this video up until now. 5, 10, 4, 17, 9, 94. Allow me to remove any and all sarcasm from the script here, because this is better than most NES emulators I found on the internet. By a lot. Yes, this is better than FCEUX. This is better than Nestopia. This is tied with Nintendulator. Of all the NES emulators I found online, including the one I created, only 4 of them scored better than this. By the way, Nintendo Switch Online has the exact same results, so I'm inclined to believe it's the exact same emulator. See, part of the fun with making this video was the genuine shock of seeing these results. This emulator passes some obscure tests. They got dummy read and write cycles in this. They got some obscure controller clocking behavior. They got proper interrupt polling. They've got interrupt hijacking in this emulator. The PPU data bus value decays. I cannot stress how cool that is. But wait, there's more. They passed every frame timing test I wrote. I feel like the effort and attention by Nintendo European Research and Development put into this emulator has been underappreciated. I just wanted to highlight the effort they put into this before I highlight some things they got wrong. Despite the overwhelming effort put into accuracy, I was quite surprised to see they aren't even trying to emulate the CPU's open bus behavior. There are some DMC-DMA timing issues, a couple unofficial instructions are emulated incorrectly, and I actually made some discoveries with the APU frame counter while making this ROM, so it's not too surprising that that behavior I discovered isn't emulated. But overall, the testless emulator fails are mostly minor ones. So, let's evaluate this emulator. This is easily an A. Maybe an A- for not trying with OpenBus. It goes without saying, I mean, did you even see that bar graph, that this is by far Nintendo's most accurate NES emulator. But just out of curiosity, let's see how every emulator made by Nintendo compares to every emulator I found on the internet. On a slight tangent, there's been a lot of talk about FPGAs lately, which are kind of like emulators but with custom hardware. As of this video, the Super Mario Bros. Any% world record was performed on a Mr. FPGA, which might bring up questions surrounding the validity. Here are the results for that and the error codes for the tests it fails. Trust me, none of these would affect the gameplay of Super Mario Bros., so the Mr. FPGA is perfectly fine for RTA speedruns. And with all this info about emulators, incredibly obscure behavior that can only occur in custom code, and a myriad of issues that don't have any impact at all on the speedrunning scene, you might ask, okay, well, who cares? Oh, you mean to tell me this emulator isn't implementing the backdrop colors for sprites should be mirrors of the backdrop colors for backgrounds? Whoa! That couldn't possibly have any effect on a speedrun, so it doesn't matter if an emulator correctly emulates that. Are you sure? I could create a tool-assisted speedrun that maliciously writes an accuracy test for some specific behavior in RAM, executes it, and then if it passes the test, crash the console, otherwise jump to the credits. This creates a situation where a less accurate emulator, incorrectly emulating even the nichest of edge cases, has an advantage over real hardware. So you can see why emulator accuracy is so important. You know, because I could do that. By the way, if you are making your own NES emulator, my ROM can be found in the description. You should totally screenshot the results and share them in my Discord. I would love to see that. I could not have made this video by myself. I gave my ROM to a lot of people for various reasons, so here's a list of everybody who helped out one way or another. If you want to support me, you can check out my game, Fantastic Fist. It's on sale. Or you can support me through Patreon, which I'm now doing. This just helps me do more research and make more stuff like this. If you watched this video and felt inspired to make your own NES emulator, I wrote up a guide in the form of a really large, free post on my Patreon. And that's about it. I hope that despite the odds, this video was entertaining. Take care.